Hi folks, welcome back again this week. We're looking into the topic of grace. I'm on a Facebook group who there's a lot of folks who really pound grace. We're saved by grace, that's it, that's all, leave it at that. Nothing else seems to matter. I disagree. There are other things that matter. A whole lot. So we're looking up grace in the Strong's. To what I know, grace in Scripture is defined as mercy, compassion, and forgiveness. Is there a time where grace ceases to be extended? And according to Hebrews 6, 4 to 6, yes, most definitely, there is a time where grace ceases to be extended to a person. And that's when they've heard the gospel fully explained, accurately explained to them. Let me get a little more light on here. Accurately explained to them, and yet they turn away. No, don't believe that. Well, grace is no longer extended to that person. Person might say, well, no, that's not what it says in the Bible, Ed. Well, yeah, that is what it says in the Bible. Remember not to cherry pick the Bible. I ran across this the other day with a gentleman I was talking to, and he was saying that we were arguing over whether Jesus was nailed through the palms or through the wrists. And I said, no, I said he was bound by the wrists from the time of his arrest forward. And the guy said, yeah, but how could he carry the cross with his wrist tied together? Gee, I don't know, but I said, you're not aware of what it says in Mark. I said, Simon of Cyrene, I said, the other Gospels all say that Jesus carried his own cross, was forced to carry his own cross. And that's not a lie. The Romans tried to force him to carry his own cross. But it wasn't working out so good, and they grabbed Simon of Cyrene and made him carry the cross. Well, which is right? Was Jesus forced to carry his own cross? Yes. And was Simon of Cyrene pulled in when Jesus kept falling down? Yes. It's all true, but you have to put the truths together to realize. And so when people say, well, it's all just by grace, they make an error. Because when you go into the book of Revelation and the seven churches, you find that the very first church, the Spirit of Grace, one of the seven spirits of God, the sevenfold Spirit of God, one of the eyes of God, because the seven eyes that surround the throne. And even at the first church, we come by grace, all right. But if we forget our first love, we are warned that God will take our lampstand away. Well, a lampstand is that which gives light. Light is understanding. And so if you don't have a lampstand, you don't have any understanding. You return to darkness, which is ignorance. What good is your grace then? Because at the second church, we find the Spirit of Truth, another of God's sevenfold Spirit. And at the Spirit of Truth, it says, if you accept that I am who I claim to be, you won't be hurt by the second death. Well, what if you don't accept who Jesus claimed to be? He claimed to be God. The Scriptures, he's the fulfillment of the Word. He's the Word in flesh. The Scriptures come to life in flesh. And the Scriptures tell us that the Christ would be Father Truth himself. having taken off his immortality and put on mortality, entering the womb of the Virgin. Growing as everything that's mortal has to grow. Presenting himself to his creation. Check these out. It says that Jesus is the great creator. All things were made by him and for him and through him. There was nothing that was made that has been made that wasn't made by Jesus. Fulfilling the scriptures in that the scriptures said they'd crucify him. I've engraved you on the palms of my hands. What do you think that refers to? If not nails. So if you don't accept the reality of the Trinity, Father Truth, the mind of God, the Spirit of Truth, love, the heart of God, and Jesus, the bodily form in which God has always stood visible before his creation. Who do you think Melchizedek was? Who was Jesus? And who is Jesus? Well, just read 1 John 5 and 20. Jesus is the true God and eternal life. Back to Isaiah 44 and 6, he's the first and the last. Apart from him, there is no God. Revelation 1, 17 and 18. I saw him, I fell on my face as though dead, and he said, don't be afraid. Get up. I'm the living one. I'm the first and the last. I was dead, and behold, I'm alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys to death and Hades. Who is it? Well, it's Jesus. At the second church, if you believe this, if this is your message, your gospel, that you believe that Jesus is Lord, you won't taste the second death. So is it just grace? By grace we come and that's it, that's all? Well, there has to be learning involved on our side of the fence. Remember the parable of the man who planted a vineyard and he went to check to see if the vineyard was producing and it wasn't? Let me read it for you. I tell you, I'm in Luke 13, start at verse 3. Unless you repent, you too will perish. Those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think that they were more guilty than the others living in Jerusalem? No, I tell you. No, they were no more guilty than everybody else in Jerusalem. Unless you repent, you too will perish. Then he told the parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. He's looking for fruit. What's the fruit he's looking for? Scriptures tell us again, the fruit of lips that confess that Jesus is who he claimed to be. He claimed to be the Christ, and the Christ was to be God Almighty himself. And even the Jews recognized that. We don't stone you for any of your miracles or good deeds or good teaching. We stone you because you, a mere man, claim to be God. Well, they kind of missed the point, didn't they? Man is not God. And they weren't looking at a mere man. They were looking at God himself in mortal form. But he rose from the dead and put his mortality back on. He's not dead. So he did not find any fruit. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, for 3 years now I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and I haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil? Sir, the man replied, leave it alone for one more year We're up to 4 years now. And I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, in the fourth year, fine. If not, then cut it down. So is something more than just we accept the grace of God? Is that enough? No, I'm sorry, it's not enough. God expects fruit. He expects us to grow. And this is where the first and second churches play such an important role. Oh, but I was baptized, people say. I went down to the river to pray. I got water dunked. But that's not what it's talking about. Jesus said he'd come and baptize us with the Spirit. 1 John 5 and 6 tells us that the Spirit is truth. We're supposed to be learning. If we love the Lord, our God, with all of our mind, all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our strength, and all of our understanding, then we'll search for God. We'll search to understand the mysteries of God. And he'll give them. If we ask, he'll give them those mysteries. But even at that, don't think, well, I asked and I don't know any more today than I did 10 years ago. Well, you might have asked, but you didn't do anything to fulfill your request, did you? You don't just ask and expect the God to do all the work. Yet you have to put a little bit of effort in yourself. Pick it up and read it. Spend some time in the Word, listening to what God has to tell you. Don't be running off to play church with a bunch of potluck supper cooks and emotional misfits. Spend some time in the Word of God. You looked up the word grace?
Yeah, well, that...
What did you find?
Wasn't actually where I was going with this, but...
Okay, go right. Ahead.
Oh, so it does come from a different word, but we can start with this one. Of manner or act, abstract or concrete, literal or figurative or spiritual, especially the divine influence upon the heart and its reflection in the life, including gratitude, acceptable, benefit, favor, gift, gracious, joy, liberality, pleasure, and thanks. And it comes from a different word, a prime verb, to be cheerful, calmly happy or well off, especially as salutation on meeting or parting. Be well, farewell, be glad, Godspeed, great joy. But I know I said grace, but what I actually wanted to look up.
Well, those definitions really suck, because if I give grace to someone else, I don't give it because I'm thankful for them. I give it because they're thankful for me. So.
Well, I think it's talking more about the person who's receiving the grace, not giving it.
Okay.
But the word I actually wanted to see the meaning of was saved. It says, by grace are ye saved, through faith, blah, blah, blah. But maybe we are not completely understanding what the word saved means, and that people are taking that word saved too far beyond what it actually means.
Okay.
So I'm gonna have to find it again. Oh, to save, deliver or protect, literal or figurative, heal, preserve, do well or be made whole. So, does Jesus save us in the sense of, if you accept Jesus, this is how you will be saved? But there's still an action involved in there on our part definitely. That people are not picking up on.
Communion.
You know, we are saved through grace, but in accepting the grace, there is an action required to move forward.
Mm-hmm.
And that is moving from the first church of Ephesus to the second church of Smyrna. Grace is just at the first. That gives you the right to eat of the tree of life. But you have to walk through that door. You have to make that choice. So yeah, Jesus is enough to save you, but there's still action required on your part. It is offered freely. The grace is given freely. And if you accept the grace and you move forward in the grace, there is salvation for you there.
Yes.
But they're not thinking of that word saved in the proper context, where it's missing something and people are adding things to it.
Mm-hmm.
So
well, according to Paul, in 1 Corinthians 10:16, he's talking about communion. I think everybody understands what I'm talking about when I speak of communion. Well, some people think it's going once a month and having a shot of wine and a wafer, something they put in their mouth. Well, Paul says, is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? What does it mean? Well, blood represents contempt. Is that simple? And is not the cup what we drink of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread, remember Jesus is the bread, that we break a participation in the body of Christ? So the contempt of Jesus in us. Now that may sound pretty strange to some people, but it shouldn't. What does wickedness have to do with righteousness? Nothing. Nada. Jack squat. Nothing. What does an unbeliever, a blasphemer, have to do with a believer? Nothing. Jesus came to bring fire on the earth. The fire of God is the truth revealed. And this, do we participate in the blood of Christ? Do we hold in contempt that one sin that God holds in contempt? Do we as well hold it in contempt? And if we don't learn the sevenfold Spirit of God, don't tell me, and practice, don't tell me that you sit on the throne of God with Jesus because you're full of shit. No, you don't. Nobody does. If that's what they believe. That learning experience and putting into action, participating in the blood of Christ. We're supposed to have power. Well, power of God's the gospel. Well, I'm afraid to tell you that today the gospel is nearly non-existent. It's hard to find. At least the gospel, it's in the Bible. It's hard to find. Wendy and I preach it. And it all hinges on Jesus as Lord. And I'm not saying Lord with small letters or anything. I'm talking Lord, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, God Almighty Himself. Jesus is God. Not a man, but God. In human form, in mortal form, but still God. He knew the beginning from the end when he was still in the womb. He baffled the wisest men at the temple at the age of 12. They couldn't keep up with his wisdom. His wisdom is eternal. He is Father Truth in mortal form. What did you want to say, honey?
I want to read Acts 15. We're going to start at verse 1, but we're going to go quite a ways in. Again, keeping in mind, do we properly understand what it means saved and what it means grace?
Okay.
Some men came down from Judea to Antioch and were teaching the brothers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom taught by Moses, you cannot be saved. This brought Paul and Barnabas into sharp dispute and debate with them. So Paul and Barnabas were appointed, along with some other believers, to go up to Jerusalem to see the apostles and elders about this question. The church sent them on their way, and as they traveled through Phoenicia and Samaria, they told how the Gentiles had been converted. This news made all the brothers very glad. When they came to Jerusalem, they were welcomed by the church and the apostles and elders, to whom they reported everything God had done through them. Then some of the believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees stood up and said, "The Gentiles must be circumcised and required to obey the law of Moses." The apostles and elders met to consider this question. After much discussion, Peter got up and addressed them. "Brothers, you know that some time ago God made a choice among you that the Gentiles might hear from my lips the message of the gospel and believe. God, who knows the heart, showed that he accepted them by giving the Holy Spirit to them, just as he did to us. He made no distinction between us and them, for he purified their hearts by faith. Now then, why do you try to test God by putting on the necks of the disciples a yoke that neither we nor our fathers have been able to bear? No, we believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved, just as they are." The whole assembly became silent as they listened to Barnabas and Paul telling about the miraculous signs and wonders God had done among the Gentiles through them. When they finished, James spoke up. "Brothers, listen to me. Simon has described to us how God at first showed his concern by taking from the Gentiles a people for himself. The words of the prophets are in agreement with this, as it is written, 'After this I will return and rebuild David's fallen tent. Its ruins I will rebuild, and I will restore it, that the remnant of men may seek the Lord, and all the Gentiles who bear my name, says the Lord, who does these things that have been known for ages. It is my judgment, therefore, that we should not make it difficult for Gentiles who are turning to God. Instead, we should write to them, telling them to abstain from food polluted by idols, from sexual immorality, from the meat of strangled animals, and from blood, and none of that is literal. For Moses has been preached in every city from the earliest times and is read in the synagogues on every Sabbath." The whole thing is the Jews are upset that the Gentiles, they want them to be circumcised because they're thinking in the flesh. All of this is explaining how with Jesus, we now have the spiritual understanding of everything. And God has extended his grace, not just to the Jew, but also to the Gentile by saying, if you are circumcised here and here, you have a right to come and eat with the rest of us. That's God's grace. But the Gentiles, it's not a done deal. Oh, well, I'm saved then. No, you've been invited to take part in the salvation that has been given freely. Jesus went to the cross. But you still are required to accept that.
Well, more than that, you've been invited to the king's banquet.
Mm-hmm.
You've been invited to sit down at the Lord's table. Do you not dress yourself to go to a banquet?
Mm-hmm.
Don't be the guy that, but he answered the call. I'm saved by grace. I'm here. I call myself a Christian. I believe, they told me Jesus is Lord, so that's fine. And I'm here, but he's not dressed. We're supposed to put on the white linen of righteousness. Do right. Repent of our sins and stop sinning. And yet it's impossible to stop sinning. But wait, if there's only one sin that condemns to death and all other sin is forgiven, or can be forgiven with repentance. If my brother sins against me, how often should I forgive him? 7 times 7? No, 70 times 7. There's no limit. If he asks for forgiveness, forgive him. And yet the man who was not dressed at the banquet, he got thrown out with the hypocrites, where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Sorry, but that's the lake of fire. He got expelled because he didn't dress himself. Well, seeking the Lord is trying to find out, what does he want of us? Each and every one of us as individuals, what does he want of us? And as we learn the sevenfold Spirit of God, the seven letters to the seven churches explains it so, so well. Don't forget your first love. Keep growing. And yet, what is it? Hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, is that right? Ephesus, E-P-H-E-S-U-S. The angel of the church of Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked men, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and have endured hardships for my name, and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. The word, that you might dress yourself to go to the king's banquet. Remember the height from which you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. That puts you right back where you began. But you have this in your favor, you hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. While Nico was a pharaoh, and the Nicolaitans are those who followed Nico, Pharaoh Nico. And Pharaoh is defined as the coiling serpent. He wants things his way. Forget God's way. He wants things his way. In other words, he's always trying to play God. So what do they hate? They hate people that are always trying to play God over them. And God condones this as a good thing. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give the right to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. So you have the right to eat at Ephesus. Have you eaten? Well, not according to the second church. Because at the second church of Smyrna, he says he'll give you the crown of life. And you won't be hurt by the second death. So you have not eaten of the tree of life at the first church. You have only been offered the right to eat. And this is what Paul's talking about in Romans. Romans 10, 9, 8. What does it say? The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith we are proclaiming. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God, that'd be Father Truth, raised Jesus from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. Justification is not salvation. Justification is the right to be saved. With your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. And what are you supposed to confess? Jesus is Lord. He's exactly who he claimed to be. He is the Christ, and the Christ is Father Truth, full of and displaying his unconditional love.
Remember, who are the poor? The poor are those who don't know God or know what he wants.
Yeah.
Are they saved? Not yet. But have they been given God's grace?
Sure.
Yeah, they can come in.
Yeah.
The one, when people didn't show up for the banquet, and they said, go out and just bring people in.
Yeah.
Well, everyone's, God's grace, God's salvation is offered freely to everyone.
Yeah.
Jew, Gentile, everyone. The poor, the ones who already know something. Well, while you're still poor, you're not saved yet. You don't know God, and you don't know what he wants. You don't know Jesus, and you don't love. Well, that means that there's an extra step involved.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So is it wrong when it says, by grace are you saved? No, but that is incomplete. There's more to that than just that. There is, you have to move forward in it.
You have to grow. You can't, a plant cannot produce seed unless it grows. A woman cannot give birth to a child, a fetus, unless that fetus grows to the point of childbirth. It's impossible. And, well, God's bride is supposed to be birthing the children of God. And it's a hard thing to do, because the children, they come to the birth canal and they don't come out. They won't admit it. Because of what? False teaching. Corrupt gospels. Men who bastardize the word of God. That's why. So, there's a little more to it. For all of my friends on Facebook, I just tell you, there's a little more to salvation than just the grace of God. The grace is offered, but when that grace is rejected, it comes a time it's no longer offered. And for all of those who listen to me every week, take note of this. The power of God is the gospel. And Jesus is coming back. Let's hope he finds us doing what he told us to do. We have the power of life and the power of death. And it's all right here. But what comes out of here comes out of here. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Let your sword be the sword of God. It can cut away sin and bring to life. Or it can cut away life and condemn to death, eternal death. But if you're not preaching the right gospel, out of the love in your heart to give people the opportunity to recognize and acknowledge and confess that Jesus is who he claimed to be, that he is Lord, that he is God the Father himself. Show us the Father, said Philip. That'll be enough for us. What did Jesus say? You ask me that after I've been among you such a long time. If you've seen me, Philip, you've seen the Father. He's telling him right flat blazing in his face. I am the Father. Where does it say he will be called the Prince of Peace, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, the Everlasting Father? Why do you think it says that? You think it's a suggestion? It's no suggestion. It's who he is. Don't ever forget your first love. Keep searching for God. I had a man just this morning say that he was unsure about remaining in a group where there was so much discussion and argument, and he called it bickering and
unproductive bickering.
Unproductive bickering. And I said, well, if you don't have discussion, if you don't come reason together, if you think that argument is evil, I don't know what I can say to help you, because that's how we come to the truth. And people like to give opinions, but are their opinions backed up by what the Bible says? It says you need two or three witnesses. So if I say that blood is figurative of contempt, do I have the two or three witnesses in Scripture that testify that that's true? Yes, I do. So, believe it or not, but without discussion, if you want to call it bickering, it doesn't bother me. But if you're not willing to participate, if you're not willing to be thankful for that and to learn from that, because you think of Pentecost, just think of Pentecost, 120 people all locked up for 10 days in the same building. And it says the wind was great. A great storm broke out. Well, what do you think it's talking about? Do you think it's an atmospheric disturbance? No, it was an argument. It was argument. People bringing up this scripture and that scripture. Yeah, but it says over here. Well, was he the Christ or is he not the Christ? Who is he? What's his identity? What does he want of us? And people bringing up scriptures, the scrolls, the parchments, and discussing the issue to the extent of argument. A huge, violent wind came upon them all. And fire appeared. The fire of God's the truth revealed. Don't tell me it's not. Look at all these witnesses concerning the fire of God. Look them up. And like tongues of fire came down and rested on each one as they were found worthy. What is he talking about? Well, when you start realizing the difference between the literal and the spiritual side of wisdom, and you start understanding this, I mean, you can't help but pick up the Bible and read stuff. And, oh my goodness, I thought the poor didn't have any coin in their pocket. But here it's telling me the poor, they don't know God nor understand what he wants. And Jesus commanded us, give to the poor. Our testimony is pretty important then, isn't it? Well, isn't our testimony what God said from the beginning was our whole purpose? Read Isaiah 44, 7 and 8, 6, 7 and 8. You are my witnesses that there is no God besides me. This is the first and last talking. But remember what I said earlier, the first and last is Jesus. Remember what 1 John 5 and 20 says? Jesus, he's the true God and eternal life. There is no other God. Things we should really, really bury deep in our heart.
And just to tie back into what I read in Acts, oh, my brain. I sit here waiting for a chance to say something, and then there's like piles up, and then finally I can't remember what I was going to say.
I'm sorry I talked too much, honey.
No, it's gone. Never mind.
Like it said in the book of Acts?
Yeah, I know, but I don't. I can't.
What did it say
up
in the book of Acts? About Pentecost, were you thinking?
No, what I read.
What did you read? That awful? I'm as absent-minded as you are, honey.
Well, that's why you got to wait till I'm ready to start filming, and you can't just start before I'm ready, because then my brain is not, it's not organized. It's all jumbled up, and then I don't have any extra memory for the stuff that comes up.
I think we've said quite a bit, though.
Well, all I wanted to do was, like, it's always good to reiterate your point when you get to the end.
Yeah.
And that's all I was really going to do, but it's all jumbled up.
Well, we were talking about grace.
I know what we were talking about. It's not helpful.
Where was the piece in Acts? Can you find it again?
Oh, yeah. How was it that Jesus saved us? He showed us the spiritual, because under the literal, no one could keep the law.
Yeah.
So how did Jesus save us? By making it so that everyone had a chance to be saved under the spiritual law.
Yes.
Instead of the literal.
The Bible calls it the royal law.
Yeah.
Which is, Jesus is Lord, love one another.
Right.
This is the royal law found in Scripture. Yeah. This is the summation of all of the Psalms, the law, and the prophets. Well, that's the entire Bible.
Yeah.
Love God and love your neighbor as yourself. It sums it all up. If you love God, you'll search for God, and you'll acknowledge and confess that Jesus is God. Does that negate the Trinity? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Don't get on that train. The Trinity teaching is correct. God is a Trinity of mind, of heart, and of action. Logic, emotion, and form, that logic and emotion is being expressed through, is the form of God not submissive to the mind of God? And does the heart of God overrule the mind of God? Never. Never. Love has to submit to truth. Emotion has to submit to logic. Eve submits to Adam, and Adam submits to God. It's that simple. That's the way it was made in the beginning. That's the way it'll be in the end. So the Trinity, Father, the mind of God, His spirit, the heart of God, and His bodily form, His one and only ever begotten bodily form, Jesus, the form of God. So there is a Trinity, all right. And the Trinity is the key to understanding. It should be what we're preaching. It is what we're preaching. Is it what you preach?
So you can really only understand what it means to be saved if you pair that the verse, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift from God, with where it says you're justified by what you believe, but you're saved by what you confess. Those two, you can't take them apart.
No.
Because that's the bridge. That's how you get from, well, how are you saved here and saved here? There's a thing in the middle. And that's your bridge right there, is those two things together.
Yes. Yeah. Enough said for this week. We love you all. Don't forget, Jesus is Lord. Love as he commanded. God bless. Bye for now.